Hello student, so today's topic of discussion is anti-malarial drugs part 1. This topic we shall be discussing under the following headings: chemical classification, therapeutic classification. Then we'll be looking into three different drugs that are the most important drugs for malaria, that is chloroquine, primaquine and quinine. So before we go into the core areas of today, we'll have a brief introduction to malaria. So all of you must be aware by now, because you have already learned about different aspects of malaria in different other subjects also, that malaria is a major health problem in India and the tropics. And malaria is caused by four species of Plasmodium parasite. They are Plasmodium vivax, Plasmodium ovale, Plasmodium falciparum and Plasmodium malariae. Of these, the most severe malaria is caused by Plasmodium falciparum. So these are the clinical features. I have just put it in a picture. So the some of the characteristic clinical features of malaria are fever with chills and sweating. There can be headache, fatigue, pain, dry cough. And when you examine the patient, you may find an enlarged spleen. So these are some of the features of malaria which can be helping in the diagnosis of the condition. Then we'll come to the life cycle of the malarial parasite. This again you have studied elaborately in your microbiology classes. So I'm just going to brief the life cycle that is relevant to the understanding of the drugs. So already I have told you the causative organism of malaria is Plasmodium. And the definitive host is the female Anopheles mosquito. And the intermediate host, as you all know, is man. So the life cycle occurs partly inside the mosquito and partly inside the man. So the part of the life cycle which occurs inside the mosquito is called as the sexual sporogony. And that part of this cycle which occurs in the male, in the man, is called as asexual schizogony. So you have two parts, that is sexual sporogony and asexual schizogony. So what happens first? So when a mosquito is biting the man, it transmits the sporozoids into the blood. The sporozoids will travel to the liver where it reproduces asexually, and this is called as the tissue schizogony. It's an asexual mode of reproduction and is called a tissue schizogony. And the product of this tissue schizogony is merozoids. Sporozoids travel to liver, reproduce asexually to produce merozoids. The merozoids infect the new RBCs and multiply in the RBCs. That is called as the blood schizogony, leading to the production of more merozoids. Finally, the RBCs become so loaded up with the merozoids that they burst and release the merozoids into the blood. And this is when the infective cycle begins. And this is the time when the person will manifest with the fever, chills, and other symptoms of malaria. Some merozoids develop into male and female gametocytes. You can see some of the merozoids, they are developing into male and female gametocytes, but some of the merozoids will remain dormant in the liver, and these are called as the hypnozoids. Some merozoids which are remaining dormant in the liver are called as hypnozoids. And why are these hypnozoids very significant? Because these can cause a relapse of infection later. Many months later, that is after the initial infection, many months later, there can be a relapse of infection. And that is occurring because of these hypnozoids which are reactivated later on. This is seen only in the case of Plasmodium vivax and Plasmodium ovale. So you have seen the merozoids are causing the symptoms of the disease. Then some of them can develop into gametocytes and some can remain dormant as the hypnozoids. Now, when the mosquito is biting the infected person, okay, this is the infected person, the mosquito is biting an infected person, the gametes are taken up along with the blood meal, and the gametocyte matures in the mosquito's gut, and fused to form a okinate. This is the process, okay? And this is a this and which will further develop into the sporozoid. This is called as the sexual sporogony. Now the sporozoids are present in the mosquito, which will travel to the salivary glands of the mosquito. And when this mosquito bites another person, it will infect that particular person. So the cycle continues. So this is the way. There are two parts, that is sexual sporogony and asexual schizogony. First, I describe the schizogony that is occurring in man, which is leading to the development of gametocytes. Also, it is causing the symptoms in the person, hypnozoids. When the gametocytes are taken up into by the mosquito, the sexual sporogony occurs. Sporozoids are formed, which is again transmitted to another man when the mosquito bites another person. Okay, this is about the life cycle of the malarial parasite. Now, I already told you what is relapse. So relapse is occurring many months later, that is after the initial infection, many months later it can occur. It is mainly because of the hypnozoids, that is the merozoids, which are remaining dormant inside the liver. When these hypnozoids become reactivated, they can, this is called as a relapse. Whereas recrudescence can occur very near the initial infection, or even during the initial infection itself, the person may be asymptomatic for some days and then again present with the fever. But this recrudescence is because of the incomplete clearance of the parasite from the blood. And the recrudescence can occur because when the parasite is resistant to the drug that has been used for treating the malaria. So relapse occurs much later and is because of the hypnozoids. It can occur in vivax and ovale, whereas recrudescence occurs much earlier or much very much nearer to the initial infection, and it can occur in any kind of plasmodia. So that is about the introduction to the antimalarial drugs. Now we are going to the fourth session. The antimalarial drugs are the drugs which are used for prophylaxis of malaria, then for the treatment of malaria, and for the prevention of relapses of malaria. For treatment, prophylaxis, as well as for prevention of relapses of malaria. Now we have got two types of classification, that is chemical classification and therapeutic classification. So first I'll be dealing with the chemical classification. So this is your, this classification you have to learn by heart. It's quite a hectic classification. And my suggestion would be that you learn the name, that is the classes, and you can at least learn one example, which must be the prominent example. So I'll just read out the classification. 4 aminoquinolins, under that you have got chloroquine, and you have got other examples also. Quinoline methanol, mefloquine, then you have got a cinchona alkaloid, quinine, biguanides, proguanil, diaminopyridines, pyrimethamine, sulfonamides like sulfadoxin, dapsone, 8 aminoquinolins, primaquine, antibiotics like tetracycline, doxycycline, clindamycin, naphthoquinone, that is atavoquinone, and naphthyridine, that is pyronaridine, amino alcohols, halofantrine, lumefantrine, and then you have got the important class that is called as a sesquiterpene lactones. Under that, you have got some important example, artesunate, artemether, arteether, arterolane. So these are all called as the artemisinin derivatives. So you can see some of the drugs I have highlighted. So these are the chloroquine, quinine, primaquine, and the artemisinin derivatives. So our principal concentration will be on these four different classes of drugs. So we are not going into the elaborate description of the other drugs. The principal drugs that are used in malaria are the ones that I have highlighted. That is chloroquine, quinine, primaquine, and the artemisinin derivatives. The other drugs, we will just have a very brief run through these drugs in the second part of the class. So first, that finishes the chemical classification. Another classification is based upon their use, that is called as a clinical classification or therapeutic classification. Under this, you are categorizing the drugs as prophylactics. That means they prevent the clinical attack of malaria. That means the attack has not happened. The malaria hasn't occurred. It is preventing the clinical attack of malaria. They can be causal prophylaxis. They can prevent the cause. They can be causal prophylactics. That is, they may be targeting the pre-erythrocytic phase in the liver. That is, the merozoites that are there in the liver, that can be targeted by these drugs. And these are primaquine, proguanil. So you can remember primaquine. So they are also called as the tissue schizonticide. So you have seen that the tissue schizogony you have already seen in the life cycle. So they are killing or they are targeting the merozoites in the liver. So they are preventing the attack. Clinical attack is not occurring. I already told you the clinical attack occurs when the merozoites are released into the blood. Now that will not happen. So the clinical attack will not occur. Then suppressive prophylaxis means the drugs which are suppressing the erythrocytic phase. Means they will somehow suppress the erythrocytic phase. So they are chloroquine. The main one is chloroquine. So you can see under the causal prophylactics, you have got primaquine, and suppressive prophylactic, you are having chloroquine. Others, if you have other examples also, if you are interested, you can remember. But at least these two examples you should be knowing. Then comes the clinical curatives. The other names are erythrocytic schizonticide. That means they are preventing. They are not preventing. They are destroying the merozoites in the RBCs. So they can be, they can treat the clinical cases of malaria. And under this, there are two types. There can be fast-acting, high-efficacy ones like chloroquine, quinine, and artemisinin. Or there can be slow-acting, low-efficacy ones like proguanil, sulfonamides, tetracyclines, and all. So what do you see principally here? You can see that primaquine is mainly a prophylactic drug, whereas chloroquine, it finds a principal use in the clinical cure or the treatment of the malaria. Although you can see chloroquine here also as a suppressive prophylaxis, but its main use is as a clinical curative. Then you have got the next category, that is radical curatives. That means these are drugs which cause the radical cure. What do you mean by radical cure? Radical cure means it is the eradication of the parasite completely from the body. That is the eradication of the hypnozoites completely from the body. Hypnozoites are present only in the case of Plasmodium vivax and Plasmodium ovale. So these radical curative drugs, they completely eradicate the parasite from the body. Under this, the example is primaquine. It has been missed here, but the example is primaquine. You have to remember, primaquine is mainly a prophylactic as well as it is a radical curative. Then gametocidal drug. These decrease the transmission of malaria from the infected person to another. It will not have any use in the infected person. It is only cutting down the transmission. Okay, so example again is primaquine. So you can see primaquine is having gametocidal action. It is having radical curative action. It's also having some amount of prophylactic action, but it is not having any clinical curative action. Now we'll discuss about the first drug, that is chloroquine. So it is a 4-aminoquinolin. It is a clinical curative drug in malaria. It rapidly acts on the erythrocytic schizonts of all the species of Plasmodium. And it can control the clinical attack in 1 to 2 days. So this is the first line drug that you have. Any person who is suspected of malaria is given chloroquine as the first drug, because it is rapidly, it can control the clinical attacks in 1 to 2 days. Now, what is the mechanism of action? This is very, very important. So first, we will see what happens normally in the Plasmodium. So the Plasmodia, they digest the, you already know, the blood meal that is taken by the mosquito. Okay, so the Plasmodia digest the hemoglobin to heme and globin in their acidic vacuole. The globin is used by the Plasmodia for nutrition. The heme is a bit toxic to the Plasmodium. So it converts the heme, the toxic heme, to a non-toxic pigment called as the hemozoin by the enzyme called as heme polymerase enzyme. is what is normally happening in the plasmodia with the hemoglobin. Okay, so they don't have any kind of toxic compound in their body. Now, what happens when the chloroquine is given? So when chloroquine is given, it concentrates inside the acidic vacuole of the parasite and raises the pH of the vacuole. It will bind to the heme to form heme phenolin complex, which will inhibit the heme polymerase enzyme. Now, what will happen when the heme polymerase enzyme is inhibited? The conversion of toxic heme to non-toxic hemozoin will not occur. So what will happen? This the chloroquine heme complex, which has been formed, it will damage the plasmodium membranes, digestive proteases, and other critical biomolecules of the malarial parasite. So there is a killing of the parasite. So this is a format, or this is a mechanism of action of chloroquine. You have to write what is happening normally, and then you have to write what happens when you are administering the chloroquine. So this is the flow chart of that. Normally what is happening, hemoglobin is split into heme and globin. Globin is utilized by the malarial parasite for nutrition. Heme toxic is converted to hemozoin, non-toxic by heme polymerase. Chloroquine, in presence of chloroquine, you will see that it is inhibiting the heme polymerase, and the chloroquine heme complex that is formed will damage the plasmodium membranes and the other critical biomolecules of the parasite. Now, you all would have heard about the chloroquine resistance. This is a very, very important problem. It's a fast developing problem. And especially Plasmodium falciparum has become resistant to chloroquine. And the resistance usually occurs because of some efflux mechanisms which pump out the chloroquine. And because of this, many of the Plasmodium falciparum species have become resistant to chloroquine. So in such cases, you may have to go for alternative drug therapy. Now, what are the pharmacological actions of chloroquine? It has got antimalarial activity. It has got activity against other parasitic infections like giardiasis and extra-intestinal amebiasis. Other than the actions in the infectious situations, the other actions are also there. That is, it has mild anti-inflammatory action, antihistaminic action, local anesthetic action, weak smooth muscle relaxant action, and even a little bit of anti-arrhythmic activity is present. So whenever you are writing the pharmacological actions of chloroquine, do not stop at the anti-malarial activity, but you have to write the others also, that is action against the other parasitic infections as well as the other actions which I have mentioned just now. Now the pharmacokinetics. So it has got a good oral absorption. It is given orally. This is a drug which has got a high cumulative property. It gets concentrated in the liver, in the spleen, in the kidney, in the lungs, in the skin, and even in the WBC. And it is very highly accumulated in retina. And so ocular toxicity can occur on prolonged use. So every time you are giving a chloroquine for a prolonged period, make sure that the person undergoes testing, the retinal testing, periodically to see if any damage has occurred to the retina. It is metabolized in liver and excreted in the urine. The T-half is 3 to 10 days. You can see it's a very, very long T-half. And because it is bound to so many tissues, it can persist in the body for a long time. Even for months, it can be persisting. Now, because of this long T-half, that is 3 to 10 days, it is often given as a loading dose. To bring about rapid action, you have to give a larger amount of the dose initially to bring about a faster action. Now, the adverse drug reactions of chloroquine, we'll classify them as ADRs occurring at low doses or after short duration of use, and the ADRs occurring at high concentrations or after prolonged use. The ADRs which are occurring after at low dose, that is the usual doses which you are giving for treatment of malaria. So nausea, vomiting, anorexia, epigastric pain. These are the very, very, very common ADRs which are seen with the chloroquine. And the person may also complain of some kind of uneasiness, uncontrollable itching, headache, difficulty in visual accommodations. These are all very, very prominent ADRs usually seen in patients receiving chloroquine for treatment of malaria. The ADRs which occur at high doses or prolonged use are usually loss of vision, loss of hearing, mental disturbances, graying of hair, rashes, photoallergy. So you can see mainly it is the retina which is damaged. When you talk about loss of vision, it is mainly the retinal damage that we are referring to. Some amounts of corneal deposits can also lead to diminished vision. So to remember, now the prolonged use is mainly in the other cases that we have described, no? That is in the in non-infectious uses of chloroquine, then only we are using it for a prolonged use. And so you can have all these ADRs developing in the patient. And if you wish, you can remember the ADRs, like imagine an old patient, old person. So that person may be having loss of vision, loss of hearing, a little bit of mental disturbances, graying of hair. You can remember as a quote to remember the ADRs occurring at prolonged on the prolonged use of chloroquine. Now, the chloroquine is contraindicated in patients who are having liver damage, severe GIT, neurological, retinal, or hematological diseases. It should not be given with other drugs, which can be with drugs like mefloquine, amiodarone, antiarrhythmics, and all. It is contraindicated. But one thing that you have to be noticing here is that it can be safely given in pregnancy. The drug of choice for malaria in pregnancy is chloroquine. So do not forget that. The dose of chloroquine is usually 250 milligram oral tablet of chloroquine phosphate is administered, and it contains 150 milligram base of chloroquine. So the tablet, the weight of the tablet will be 250 milligram, but the how much of the chloroquine will be present in it? It is only 150 milligram base. Now the chloroquine therapeutic uses malaria. It is used for the clinical cure against all the species. You can see all the species are there. But nowadays, Plasmodium falciparum is found to be resistant, but some of it is still sensitive. And giardiasis and extra-intestinal amebiasis. Then other uses, rheumatoid arthritis, discoid lupus erythematosus, lepra reactions, infectious mononucleosis, and in photogenic reactions. So these are also very important. Many times you miss to write the other uses of chloroquine. This also has to be written in your answers whenever you are writing about the chloroquine short note. So next we go to the quinine. So quinine is an L-isomer alkaloid which is isolated from the cinchona bark. This is one drug which you have always been hearing right from your school days. And this again is a clinical curative drug. Just like the chloroquine, it is also a clinical curative drug. And it is even active against the falciparum, which is resistant to chloroquine. The mechanism of action is similar to chloroquine. So the same thing you have to write again, whatever we mentioned about the inhibition of heme polymerase, the same thing you will mention here in the quinine also. One problem with the quinine is that it has got a higher toxicity than chloroquine. That is the main problem with quinine. Now we see the adverse reactions. So the adverse reactions which are occurring with a single large dose or higher therapeutic doses of quinine given for a longer period are collectively referred to as cinchonism or synchonism. And they consist of the following features: tinnitus, which is very characteristic. Then nausea, vomiting, headache, mental confusion, vertigo, difficulty in hearing, visual disturbances, diarrhea, delirium, fever, tachypnea, respiratory depression, pulmonary edema, hypoglycemia. These are all collectively called as the synchronism. In some patients, synchronism can develop even at therapeutic doses, means normal therapeutic doses. Synchronism usually develops at large doses, but in some individuals, it can even develop at therapeutic doses itself. And that is called as idiosyncrasy, which you have already, I guess, learned in your general pharmacology classes. Then hemolysis can occur with quinine in pregnant women and patients with Plasmodium falciparum. And because of the hemolysis, hemoglobinuria can occur. And this is called as black water fever. And this can lead to kidney damage. It is highly fatal. The therapeutic uses of quinine are in malaria, principally. It can be used in uncomplicated chloroquine-resistant falciparum malaria. So I have told you, falciparum has developed resistant to chloroquine. So in such cases, you can give quinine. And in these cases, you can give oral quinine. In case of complicated and severe malaria, including cerebral malaria, you can give IV quinine. That is, the route of administration of quinine will be IV in such cases. Other than malaria, quinine can also be used for nocturnal muscle cramp treatment. Then the last drug for today's part one discussion is primaquine. It's a 8-aminoquinoline. It is most active against liver hypnozoids. As I already told you when I was discussing about the clinical classification, this is one drug which is very active against the liver hypnozoids. It has got weak action against the erythrocytic stage of vivax only, not much action against on the erythrocytic stage of falciparum. In short, we can say it is not of much use for the clinical cure of malaria. It has also got gametocidal action against all the species. The mechanism of action of primaquine is really not very well known. Some of the proposed mechanisms are that it is converted to electrophiles, which generate reactive oxygen species, and this could interfere with the electron transport in the parasite. The primaquine is even said to bind to and alter the properties of protozoal DNA. So what is the mechanism is not clear. Probably it is generating reactive oxygen species, which are causing damage to the electron transport and even binding to the protozoal DNA. The adverse effects of primaquine are not many. Mostly it is gastrointestinal, epigastric distress, abdominal cramps, and this can be minimized by taking the drug along with the meals. Others are hemopoietic ADRs, like mild anemia, methemoglobinemia, cyanosis, and hemolytic anemia in G6PD deficiency patients. So you can already have seen that some of the drugs can cause this hemolytic anemia. So primaquine is one such drug which can cause hemolytic anemia in G6PD patients, deficient patients. Then primaquine contraindication, it is contraindicated in pregnancy and G6PD patients. Then primaquine therapeutic uses, remember, radical cure of relapsing malaria in mainly in vivax and ovaid also. The dose is 15 milligram daily for 14 days along with the dose of chloroquine. We'll again discuss this in great detail under the management of malaria. But you have to remember the dose of primaquine is 15 milligram daily for 14 days. You have to remember this along with the session. Then it is also used for gametocidal action to kill the gametes and cut down transmission of malaria in falciparum malaria. The dose is 45 milligram of single dose with chloroquine. So you can see that it is given in vivax and falciparum. But in vivax, the idea of giving primaquine is for radical cure, that is to destroy the hypnozoids so that there is no relapse of the malaria. Whereas if you give, and the dose is 15 milligram for 14 days. Whereas in falciparum malaria, you're giving primaquine, you're giving it a single dose of 45 milligram, but that is for gametocidal action, that is to kill the gametes and cut down the transmission of malaria. Now this session will be continued in the next part. Thank you for hearing.